Hi everyone, and welcome to our next session about intercompany trading in Dynamics 365 Finance and Operations and what's new into the Dynamics 365 Finance and Operations into the latest release, which is 10.0.13. We got two speakers today, Rachit and Ammar. With this one, I'll just hand over to our speakers today, Ammar and Rachit. The stage is for you. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Faisal. Hello, everyone. Thank you, ANZ D365 FinOps team, for providing us this platform where we can enhance our knowledge and share things related to finance and operations. Thanks to the community leader, Faisal Farid, as well, for putting lots of efforts in building this user group and to give me opportunity to present a session to you all. I hope that all of you will be safe during this COVID times and helping each other to cope up with these difficult times. My name is Ammar Khan. I'm a senior consultant in DXC Technology based in Melbourne, Australia. I look after the areas of supply chain and manufacturing, such as procurement, sales, inventory management, production planning, and production assembly. I have a vast experience of implementing Dynamics AX in different countries and industries as well. So, Rachit, if you can introduce yourself now.
Sure. Thank you, Ammar. Hi, everyone. My name is Rachit, and I am working with Infosys based in Melbourne. I've been implementing Dynamics for almost 15 years now, and my profile is mostly related to solution architecture and technical architecture. I look after the implementation methodologies and throughout the various phases of the project. So that's my key area of expertise. I'm looking forward to share some knowledge with you all and also looking forward to get some feedback. Thanks, guys. Back to you, Ammar.
Thanks, Rachit. Okay. Coming to our agenda. So if I talk about today's agenda, I will be giving you an overview of company intercompany trading. Then I will be moved to what are the types of intercompany, a few of the setups related to intercompany, which are really important. Then I will be showing you the user journey, how you will be going into D365 with the help of a business case. And then there would be a small walkthrough of intercompany features in Dynamics 365 with a deep dive. In the end, I will be focusing on some important considerations, which would be related to what questions need to be asked before implementing intercompany setups. The next area would be to present to you by Rachit regarding the latest release of Microsoft Dynamics 365 Finance and Operation. He will update you what's new in 10.0.13 and will walk through to some key features as well in D365. So that's our agenda is. Now, moving to our topic, which is an overview of intercompany, how we can use the intercompany in D365. The reason of choosing this topic is that currently I have seen most of the client which are using D365 has multiple companies. And I have found that clients are using this functionality more and more. This might be the reason as business has changed over the years and companies have established more branches all over the world to reduce their operational costs, such as cost of producing goods. You can see that many companies all over the world has opened their branches, such as, in the genuine case, we can see the China. In China, many of the companies have opened their manufacturing plants there so that they can save some cost. I have just picked an example of Nestle. Nestle, you can see that Nestle headquarters is based in Switzerland, but you can see all its branches all over the world, such as Nestle Australia here. We have in Australia. So if we talk about the common scenarios happening on our client are mostly they are buying some items or services between each other, between different legal entities. Other thing can be sharing some sort of fees, cost allocation, royalties, and financing activities. So basically intercompany accounting is involved recording of a financial transaction between different legal entities within the same parent company. So if I go to the types of intercompany in D365, we have some different types of intercompany. We need to decide with our client that what type he will be using. For example, if we talk about the first one, which is a purchase order initiated intercompany chain, also known as two-legged. An intercompany chain in which the initiator means the person who is first taking the step of intercompany is through a purchase order. So in this case, we will start our intercompany process by creating a purchase order first, and then the sale order will be auto created in other entity, which is our related entity, which I will be also showing in my upcoming demo. Second is the sales order initiated intercompany chain, are known as two-legged as well. But in this case, SO is created first by selling company and auto purchase order is created in other entity. So the initiator in this case, so the initiator of the intercompany is the entity who is creating an intercompany SO. Third type is where a sale order is created by an external customer. We don't have an inventory to fulfill the demand of that customer, and we need those items, goods from our other company based in any other region or in any other country. So these are the three types which we need to just ask from our client that what specifically they will be using, because few of the setups are related to that. Once it decided, it will be good to have those setups configured. Now moving to our few of the setups which are really important. So these are the setup which need to be configured before we want to run intercompany smoothly. If I talk about the first one, which is the same item should be present in both the legal entities, buying and the selling entities. If you have opened an item in one legal entity, we can release the item to other entity and can configure other remaining specific setups. So during my implementation, I found that Microsoft D365 does not support procurement categories. So the work around would be to use the service item for that. So make sure that you cannot use some procurement categories for your intercompany transactions. The second is that vendor and customer should be created. Vendor in purchasing entity and the customer in the selling entity should be created. Sales price or purchase prices should be set up. If we are not using cost price as a pricing factor, then you need to make sure that the purchase price and the sales price should be set up. The fourth is the default storage dimension, such as site and warehouse, should be present on item or a customer or a vendor. Why this is important? You know, as you are aware, whenever we are creating purchase order and the SO system does not allow us to save the purchase order or SO unless we give site and warehouse, as they are a mandatory setup. So when system will be populating auto sales line on the other company, so we need to make sure there should be a default site and warehouse so that system could pick, and then system can create a sales order line very smoothly. Okay, so same case here, we have to just look that same case. If intercompany is initiated from a selling company, then in the purchasing company, storage dimension will be required either on item or our vendor. So we have one report, so we can have the proper setups including. Right now, if you could see that we have one, we have two reports basically. But right, I have this is the most common report which is used by us. So you can have this available report in inventory management inquiries and reports session, inventory and under the heading of inventory value reports, intercompany goods in transit, which will be showing you all the transactions of that. Moving to my next slide. Okay. So these are the few setups which you need to make sure that it should be set up correctly. In my example, if you could see in my example, DEMF is the vendor and USMF is the customer. So once you set up this, you can just activate the relationship, if you could see that, whenever you want it. So just a tip here, during your project implementation of Dynamics 365, and you are on the face of migrating legacy data such as purchase orders and sales order, you need to make sure that the strategy for migration of an intercompany sales order and purchase order should be discussed with client and it should be agreed. Because if you would be having a setup of intercompany activated See, if you have done the setup activated, then what system will be doing, whenever you will be uploading the legacy purchase order, system will be creating a dependent sale order in the other entity. So it needs to be decided that with your migration activity or cutover activities, that how you will be taking those purchase orders and sales order. So this is the first setup where we are just creating a trading relationship. Now moving to our second setup, which is a purchase order policies. So in the setup, you can determine, first of all, I will go for this one, which is set up purchase action policies, original sale order, direct delivery. In this setup, you can determine auto posting and printing of your document, such as printing packing slips and invoice for original sales order, direct delivery orders, and auto posting of invoice as well. I will come back to you what is direct delivery orders. I will explain you what is exactly the direct delivery order. Same you can set up for intercompany purchase order direct delivery as well. Then there is a print packing slip automatically. What this checkbox, you select this parameter to automatically print the packing slip on the original sale order when the packing slip on the intercompany sales order is posted. The second one is the post invoice automatically. Select this parameter to post the invoice automatically for the original sales order when you post the intercompany sales order. So these are the few checkbox which you need to consider. Then I will move to that print invoice automatically, which is that one. So select this parameter to print the invoice if you want to print the invoice automatically for the original sales order when the invoice in the intercompany sales order is posted. So it seems to be, you know, when you will be just configuring this, you need to keep, if you want to automate your few of the processes, you can just put this checkbox. Now coming to the what was direct delivery concept. The concept of direct delivery is that, for example, you created a SO for a customer, and in your organization, you don't have enough stock to fulfill the customer demand. So you can raise a direct delivery order, which will link with this sales order. So when the goods will be ready on the vendor side, your vendor will directly dispatch those goods to your customer. So here we have skipped the process of delivering to your company first and then dispatching to the customer. What is the benefit of it? It will save our time and cost as well. Okay. Second setup, if I go into the second setup, which is related to intercompany, this intercompany purchase order prices. Second setup is if you put this checkbox, the system will search for the prices and discount at the purchasing site, because with this setup, we are first initiating the purchase order. If you have configured this setup, so make sure you are the person who are initiating the purchase order. So this one, price and discount search one. These two are the other ones which allow a person who is creating a purchase order to allow the price edits and discount edits. So these are just a controlling, we can say that a controlling checkboxes, which can be put if we don't want to change the prices if somebody is initiating it. Okay, so the next is, this is charges allocation. So when using direct deliveries, you can select an allocation method for charges to apply to the intercompany purchase order, such as on the basis of net amount, quantity, per line, and etc. The fourth setup, if I talk about the fourth setup, this is known as a synchronization parameters. The customer information parameter in the header group, for example, this one header, and intercompany sale order controls the customer information synchronization. When the customer information option is enabled, the header information is synchronized from the intercompany purchase order to the intercompany sale order. So basically what you are doing, you are just moving few of the information, synchronizing the data between purchase order and SO. So for example, the delivery address. For example, if there would be a direct delivery order, so vendor don't know about your customer address. So when you will be making that direct delivery orders, the customer delivery address will auto copy to that sale order, and then the customer can directly dispatch it to your other customer. So these are the few setups which you need to take care about. Next setups are purchase value mapping. So moving to basic, if I move to the this purchase value mapping, the trading partner must find a common base for their company data. The two companies in the intercompany scenario with their vendor or customer relationship can communicate with one another because they have the same value parameters. So make sure these value parameters should be same. For example, in purchase entity, there would be a different mode of delivery. There would be a different delivery term, different charge codes, different reason codes, different disposition codes. So here I have selected our option that the purchasing company will be using its own these delivery codes and delivery terms. So same when I will be going to the next setups, there is a sales or setup for sales value mapping as well, where we will be also putting this hour so that we should not have any problem. So here you have to note that all value mapping for intercompany must be different from not specified. With this selection, this data synchronization between transaction will fail. If it would not be specified, you will be getting those errors during your intercompany transaction. I recommend that you never have any not specified code for your active relationship. So I will recommend that it would be always our here. Okay, so moving to the next one, which is a purchase agreement policies. We can set up prices through purchase agreements policies for our intercompany vendors and customers as well. So these are the few setups. For example, if you will be putting allow setting on hold and effective, the person who is initiating or on the purchasing side can allow the hold of he would be having the authority to hold and unhold the purchase agreement. The second thing is allow editing of validity period, and then the same allow price edits and allow discounts added. So this setup is more repetitive but related to sales and purchase entities. So if I come into the sales order policies, so here you can need to define sale order policies. First, we define purchase order policies, and then we define sales order policies. So here, the first one is the sales order number sequence. For example, when I will be creating a purchase order and auto the sales order will be creating in the other entity, what would be the number sequence of that? So we can set the number sequence of that, for example, company plus original number, even number sequence code as well, or an original number. So company plus number means that your company, for example, if my company name is USMF, so in the other sales company, it would be coming USMF dash SO number, and then the PO number. The other was, for example, original number. So you can have the purchase order number same into the other entity as well. And the other was a number sequence code, which you can put as according to your needs. Okay. So the next is you can default the payment journal setting as well, but it is not mandatory. Then in some intercompany relationship, the intercompany vendor is advised to sell the items to the intercompany customer at a price that is equal to the cost price instead of applying trade agreement or standard purchase price. So you can use the cost price as well. So if you want to use the cost price, you can just put that checkbox. The next is the checkbox which will help to look where the prices and discount will be searched initially. As I showed you in the that purchase order policies as well, there was an option there. So when you are initiating the purchase order from a sales side, so this first checkbox is really important, that where system will be looking after the price. Okay, the last is this one, which is related to the synchronization of data, that how the customer information, RFA number or a badge number or a serial number will be moving or how it will be transferring to the purchase order. Okay, so Then we have the same sales value mapping. You remember I showed you that it was on the in the back slides. It was related to purchase value mapping. Now it is related to a sales value mapping. And you can here, you can just see that I have also marked our here. So because selling company has its own mode of delivery and the purchasing company has its own mode of delivery. So this we have make it for the consistent so that we can we could not have these errors. Okay, and this is the same, you know, previously it was purchase agreement policies. And now you can see that we have this related to sales agreement policy. So if somebody is creating from the sales side, then he has the option to allow edit those prices, validity period, or for example, discounts. So this. Okay, so this was the setups, which was really important. You have to do this setup in a correct manner. Otherwise, you will be getting so much errors and it will, you know, just complicate your intercompany process. So if I come to the user journey, which is, you know, I will take you to the demonstration of this particular case. Right now, you can see that DEMF, a purchasing company based in US, is buying a product mid-range speaker from its interrelated company, which is USMF, a selling company. So I have a company. I'm in DEMF. So I will be buying from USMF, which is also my related company, and it is based in Europe. So intercompany prices right now is $330 per unit in my case and has been set up in trade agreement. No, as you know that we can set up the prices on the purchase price tab on the release product. We can set up the prices on the trade agreement and we can also set up the prices on purchase or sales agreement. So right now in my case, I have just set up this price on the trade agreement, which is purchase journal. So we can see that I have bought some D001 mid-range speakers, which is in a site 111 to quantity with this one and the net amount. And once I will create this purchase order, you can see that this information will be automatically created in the other entity. So it's saving our time as well. And you know there is a coordination between two and the relationship between there as well, which will help us. Okay, so let me just move to my demo. Just give me a while, my comment is getting started. Okay. So as you remember that DEMF was my basically a company, a purchasing company. So if I go into the, which I have showed you the previously setups, if I go into the all vendors, so I can see that this is my basically a vendor, Contoso Entertainment, which is in the other company. So you have to go into the journals and then you can go into the intercompany. So you remember I showed you some screens, trading relationship, purchase order policies, purchase value mapping, purchase agreement policies. All these setups are coming here. The good thing here is that, for example, if you are setting this intercompany vendor on one side, on the, for example, I'm just on right now on the purchasing side. So once you will set up here, for example, sales order policy, it will auto be translating to the other entity as well. So you don't need to do the setup again in the other entity. So system will auto, you know, it's a shared one. So once you are setting something here, it is already going into another company, which is your customer entity. Okay. So these were the few setups. Here I have showed you the vendor setups. Now, what I will show you one more thing that we can check the on-hand inventory as well, that how much is the on-hand inventory in the other entity which we want to purchase from. If I go into the inventory management and into the on-hand list. So this is the item D001, if I could apply. So there is a tab you know, it was not before, you know, we have this tab, intercompany on hand. You can check that in US. See, DEMF is my company and USM if my selling company. So I can see that how many items are available there in USMF, which will be selling me. So now what I will do, I will go while seeing this screen that, you know, I have enough inventory. I have to just duplicate. Okay. And you can see that in UFM, there are two items of this D100. Okay. So now I will create a purchase order. So you can create a purchase order from AP as well. You can create a purchase order from procurement and sourcing as well. I will go to the all purchase order screen. I will click new. Okay, I will select my that particular vendor, which is the US0001. Okay, all information was I put in as a default, so it has been copied. Here you can see that the intercompany checkbox has been marked to yes. For example, if I will select any other vendor, see the checkbox is marked to no. So because I was having a relationship with that US001 vendor. So that's why this, you can see that here. But here you have an option to yes, and you can off the intercompany as well for if you want to create only a purchase order, not an intercompany purchase order. So yes, click OK. OK, so I will select here my item, which is D100. OK, I have a default sites and default there, two quantity, all good. 330 is the price, same which I have showed you in my Excel example. So all good, everything is fine. I will go into purchase. I will confirm this purchase order. I think check again related. Just hold on. Okay. Yep. Usually, what happens when you create a purchase order? There was a message which I missed. So you can see that when I create the purchase order, just ignore this message. The sale order was already created. See, intercompany sale order was created in the other entity. So you have this message whenever you create the purchase order, and there was a relationship between these two entities. So if I go into the, for example, when I confirm the purchase order, okay, so you can check that what order has been created in other entity by going into general tab and related orders. So it will show you all the related order. So you can see that if there would be any sales order related, it will be showing here. If it would be an intercompany sales order, it would be showing here. So this is the order which has been created in USMF entity. So if I double click it, so there are many ways to go there to that one. If I double click it, you can see that I was in other entity. Now I have been moved there to the USMF automatically. And here I'm on the sales order. So so if you want to be on the from the same screen, if you want to go, system will automatically change the entity and it will take you to the that sales order of other entity, unless you can go, you can open another tab and you can just go to that. So you can see that when if I go back, when I created this purchase order, the sales order was already created and the related order was also came here for the information. So I will go to that related sales order again. And now I can see that all is good. To see all the two quantity unit price has been copied. See, you remember that I told you that this is really important. So you need to make sure it should be somewhere on the item on the customer, because right now our initiated process was purchase order. So on the customer or an item, it should be there. Otherwise, you know, it will give you the error. It will not create an auto line there. Okay, so what I will do, I will go there and I will generate a picking list. Basically now I'm just giving my warehouse individuals this information. Click OK. I will click OK. and then a picking list will be created. So picking list is help us if you, you know, it depends on a different client's requirement, but in usually cases, picking list is, we are sending this information to our warehouse workers so that they can pick those quantities. After that, once they pick those quantities, so they can just do this picking list registration and it mark it completed. And then they, when the goods are going out through the truck from your staging dock or something, then you can post the packing slip. So at the stage of a packing slip, basically the inventory will be reduced. Before the picking list registration and when I create the picking list, it was quantity was only picked, but it was not reduced. So it also depends on your customer requirement. So when I click the delivery note, it will reduce my quantity. Okay, so I have created this packing slip or a delivery note. It's depend on the labels. If you are in the US, it is packing slip, but if you are in the Australian company, it would be coming a delivery note. So every country has its own labels and mostly known documents things. Okay, now I have created a packing slip. Now what I will do, I will create an invoice. So these all transactions I'm just doing into my selling company. I have just dispatched the goods. Now I am just basically invoicing as well my intercompany vendor. So this, you can see that the invoice has been also created, and we can see in the journals as well that the invoice has been created. Okay, now what I will do, basically now the ships are into a truck or sea or air flight. So I will go back to that. Now I have come into the DEMF company, which is our purchasing company. So what I will do here, I will receive the goods. So see, when I click the product receipt, okay, so you can see that the product receipt number has been already copied here. Basically, this is the delivery challan or a packing slip number of that intercompany customer, because usually here we put whatever our vendor is sending us. So our vendor was the other company. Now we can see that the system has already copied his delivery challan number to our product receipt number, and the quantity is there, and we can mark it to okay. So now I'm receiving the goods into my warehouse. Once it will be received, my quantity will be increased. For example, my quantity was before it was 5 quantity. So my quantity has been increased from 2 and has become 7. Okay. So after that, once I will go to the invoice, you know, I'm just referring to that synchronization which I was talking about. So in system, there is a synchronization which we found in the delivery while creating a product receipt as well. The delivery note number was already copied. And here also you can see that the invoice date and the invoice number has been already copied, because when usually we are booking the invoices, we have to give the invoice number and the invoice date. So it should get posted. So these all has been basically, you can see that the invoice date and the number has been automatically copied from the sales order invoice, which we did in the other company. What I will do, I will post this. So the invoice is getting posted. Yeah, so the invoice has been posted. Now the simple process of intercompany, this is, you know, the process is quite simple. It depends on the client requirement. What are the, you know, in middle of there, at some time it happens that we have some vendors back in China. So we just want to bring it back through, you know, we have to invoice it first for inbound transportation management, because it's depend on our Incoterms. So different cases can become, but it is the simplest way or the case which I have showed you, so that you can easily run the intercompany transaction between two legal entities. Okay. So If I, I will come back to my slides. Okay. So a few of the important consideration you need to make sure before you are configuring this intercompany setups. A few of the, what I would advise you to just ask a few of the questions before going into deep down into your intercompany setups. First of all, is that what type of intercompany will the client be using? For example, which company will be the initiator of an intercompany purchase order and intercompany sales order? Because it depends, you know, for example, if the intercompany setup is starting from the purchase order side, then you don't need to give the sales order prices. You have to only give the purchase prices. Once you give the purchase prices, it will be automatically copied to the sales order, unless they have any other intercompany pricing policies. So the second was, you know, which I mentioned here, that what are the intercompany pricing policies and how prices will be maintained in system, whether the purchasing company will be maintaining the prices or the selling company will be maintaining the prices. So these are related on the intercompany pricing policies between each other. The third thing was the information about mode of deliveries. You remember that I told you that every company would be having a different mode of deliveries. So you need to make sure that what mode of deliveries you will be using here. The next is the information about any tracking dimension, badge and the serial number. So, you know, we have some tracking dimension in D365. So what happens if you have an item which is a batch track or a serial track? And you remember that when I was doing the product receipt, the DC number was already copied onto the product receipt. So even serial number also copied there. So it saves our time, because what we need to do whenever we are doing, whenever we are just receiving the goods, what we need to do, we need to go to the registration process, and we have to register the serial number. So if you have just put the checkbox there on the setups, then system will look after the, if it would be having a serial number, what system will do? System will copy that serial number to your purchase order. So you can skip that registration process as well. And same like for the batch number as well. Then there is other thing regarding the information about direct deliveries order as well. For example, most of the customers are in Australia and my manufacturing plant is based in China. So whenever I get an order from the Australian customer, so then I request something to be manufactured from my China entity. So and this is a very known process in different clients, that you created a sales order in that purchasing entity. And with that sales order, you can just create a direct delivery order, which is also an intercompany. So what will happen? You create a sales order. With that sales order, you created a purchase order as well with your intercompany, other company, which is based in China. And what they will manufacture the goods and they will send it to you, and then you can dispatch it to your customer. So in this cost, in this direct delivery concept, you have a relationship of sales order, intercompany purchase order, and an intercompany sales order. So these are the few of the scenarios you can ask from your client, that what are these scenarios, and then you can easily configure intercompany transactions. So that's all from my side. I hope that you guys have I tried to use some basic information so that you initially should have some idea of intercompany, how it process into D365. So I will be moving. I will be handing over to Rajit for his other session, which we have already planned, which is what's new or change in Dynamics 365 Finance and Operation 10.0.13. Thank you. I will come back to you for any questions at the end of the end of the session. So don't worry about that. I will love to answer those questions. Thank you.
Thank you, Amar. Hi guys, this is Rachit. So Amar, that was really insightful session, and thanks a lot for sharing that knowledge with the group. And thanks everyone who has joined this session. Appreciate taking time over the weekend to join these things. I will start sharing my screen and then we kick off. I hope you can see my screen now. Yeah. Okay. So I will be talking about what's new in Dynamics 365 latest update. I will be talking for around 15-20 minutes on this in this session, and we'll give a walkthrough of a basic understanding of what is a release cycle, what is the release cadence, and what are different programs available for customers and partners wherein they can engage with Microsoft to make this process a bit smoother for them. What are different tools available in Dynamics ecosystem to help partners and customers consume these updates. Summary of new features, and then I'll give a demo on few cross-platform features which are applicable to all module and can be used by the end users. So first thing and the basic thing about release cycle is to understand the concept of waves. So every year there are two waves released by Microsoft. So wave is basically a time period in which the features and hotfixes are released. So wave one runs from April to September, and wave two runs from October to March. So when you hear about we are in wave two 2020, that means, okay, all the features which will get released between October to March for year 2020 is wave two. So currently we are in wave year 2020, and on 1st October, Microsoft launched, did an event where they launched this whole new wave two program and kicked off this journey. So this wave one, wave two is not only applicable to just finance and operation, it is applicable to the whole suite of applications coming under Microsoft Dynamics 365. So these roadmap plans are uploaded on Microsoft websites. You can always download it, go through it, share it with your customers so that you know what is coming. So this is a representation of waves, right? So we understand what is a wave now. Now, what also happens is wave is not one release, right? So don't misunderstand wave with one, you know, one release with packed with full goodies. Wave is just a encapsulation or, you know, high level bird's eye view of looking at the releases. Wave is not delivered as one package. Wave is just a consolidation of features which are getting released in a particular months of the year, right? What actually is released is an update, right? So it's basically an update. It's not an upgrade experience anymore. So Microsoft releases 8 service updates every year. And this is interesting. So here we see these blue circles. These are the months in which the update is released by Microsoft. When we say update is released, it means it is generally available by all the customers and partners worldwide to consume it, install it, and play around with it. Now, this 8 releases are backward compatible, which means the runtime is backward compatible, and that is the commitment from Microsoft that they don't want to introduce breaking changes. In case they do, they inform the community via different channels. I'll come to that on the next slide, what are those different programs available. But as a customer, if you want to stay on the Microsoft support system, you need to consume at least 2 service updates in a year, which means you can pause up to 3 consecutive updates at a time. So these two statements are, they go hand in hand. So for example, you are in April and you don't want to consume this update. So you can pause it for April, May, July, but then in August, you have to consume the update. So you can't skip that. So you have to take an update after skipping 3 updates. Now you can plan this escape because of some transformation undergoing at the company, or your project is going live in a particular month and you don't want to disrupt that whole project. So there can be different reasons for different customers and partners to pause these updates, but you can only pause up to 3 consecutive updates. So this is something we can't skip. It's a evergreen version. It's always recommended to be on latest version to start using the new features. And with the new update, there are also hotfixes released. So I hope this gives some clarity on the release cadence, how many updates are there in a year, how many updates you can skip, and how many times you have to update in order to stay in line with Microsoft support. Now, so what we are trying to show in this slide is what are different programs available for customers and partners to engage with Microsoft. So this is a representation of how those features are being shipped out from Microsoft product team. So what you see, Ring Zero, is something happening inside Microsoft within the product team. And then Ring 1, 2, 3, 4, up to 4 is where a feature becomes generally available as a part of a update. So if you see, there is something, and in fact, a lot of, you know, action happening before the feature is released to market. So what are these programs? I just want to take a couple of minutes to give you an overview. So Ring 1 is called a release validation program. So this is a program for customers. What it does is basically it helps customers to reduce their chances of breaking their extensions. So a lot of customers have a worry that when they install or consume an update, it will break their test cases. And in order to reduce that risk, customers can actually record their test cases using RSET, and they can share a sample database of their business data. Now, customers are always encouraged to remove any confidential information from it before sharing with Microsoft. But the objective of the program is customers can share their data and their testing suites with Microsoft. And when Microsoft is in Ring 1 phase, they will run their test cases on your, you know, code, on your test cases and on your database. That will reduce chances of breaking a change when the feature is generally available. So this is a very, you know, good program where customers can engage directly with Microsoft and make sure that their test cases have been executed by Microsoft even before it becomes generally available. Then comes Ring 2. So once things are good with Ring 1, then Ring 2 is a preview early access program. Now this is for all the type of community people, where partners, customers, and ISVs can engage with Microsoft. It's a very good program. I would highly encourage everyone to sign up for this. You can just Google it and go to the experience.ideas page, and you can register for this program. Microsoft will add you to the Yammer group, and then you can directly engage with the Microsoft product team and other similar people worldwide to share your experience. Also, you get access to these release packages before they are made generally available. So as a part of PEEP program, you can actually download the upcoming versions which are not generally available yet. You can install it into your tier 2 environments, play around with it, give an early feedback to Microsoft. You can start your testing to identify if something is breaking or not. So by participating in the PEEP program, you get early visibility to what's coming, and you also engage directly with Microsoft. So that is Ring 2. What happens in Ring 3 is, Ring 3 is a first release program, and this is for customers. So this is for those customers who are willing to take that extra risk or additional collaboration with Microsoft. So they say, yep, we know we have to consume this update. Let's partner with Microsoft. And they became the first one to apply that update in their environments. Now, what happens is, because a customer is partnering with Microsoft and letting them apply that update in their environment, Microsoft also has a commitment to serve them as soon as, you know, if something is breaking, if they have found any breaking change. Microsoft core team is directly keeping an eye on the customers who are taking part in the first release program. So this is another program where customers can participate. And then comes Ring 4, which is the generally available. So when we say, hey guys, 10.0.13 is GA, that means it is here, Ring 4. And this is where I see a lot of people start thinking about and looking into what's coming and what has impacted, been impacted in my project. But there are other rings where people can participate and take advantage and reduce their risk of identifying any breaking changes. So this slide was to just give an introduction of what type of programs are available and how we can proactively deal with consumption of one version updates. Cool. Going forward, so once you receive an update, how you can check if it is breaking something or not. Of course, one way is to do manual testing, but there are a lot of tools which we can use to automate this consumption. One of the quite famous tool is RSET, which is Regression Suite Automation Tool, where you can author your test case and run it and check if something is breaking. You also can use LCS environment update settings. Make sure it is updated for all your customers. It helps you to identify which environment gets auto-updated when the version is released, and you can control your update settings there. Feature management workspace is a very good workspace in Dynamics, which I will show in the demo. This basically helps you to analyze what has been released and what you want to enable. So that is another layer of, you know, control. So once you apply update, everything doesn't get enabled automatically. You can go to feature management workspace and cherry pick few features. There are some features which gets enabled automatically because they become part of the platform, and there's no reason not to enable them. But you can always see all that list in feature management workspace. Data task automation is another framework which can help you to automate your creation of data and reduces the manual effort of managing your key configurations in the environment. Cool. Moving on. So summary of 10.0.13. So 10.0.13 got generally available in September. And if you look at my previous slide, September was not supposed to get released. It was actually supposed to get released in August, but due to some delays, it got a bit late. But yeah, it got released in September 2020. There were 60 new features released in the application, 950 hotfixes. So you can imagine how much Microsoft is focusing on improving the known issues, or how much customers are reporting. There were 5 features which got enabled by default. So as I mentioned, there are some features which are baked into the platform and they get enabled by default. And there is also a type of feature which once you enable, you cannot disable it. So you need to really test these features in sandbox environments before you enable them. And Microsoft also releases some features in preview mode to gather some early feedback from customers. So 3 new preview features were related. Are released as a part of this latest update. So I recently blogged about this, so you can read about what are those features. But we also have created an Excel file where you can actually see, we ran some data queries and dumped that into an Excel and created a pivot chart. So out of these 60 features, you can see, right, retail and commerce, there are a lot of new features in retail and commerce, which is around 9. Then accounts receivable, tax module is having a lot of features. So this is a breakup, just a bird's eye view of what features are released in which module. So we have a list, complete list here in this sheet. We will be sharing this sheet on our LinkedIn channel. You can download and read it. With regards to hotfix, there were 950 hotfixes, which is quite a big number. And then we have a breakup here. So you can see here that lot of fixes in localization features, retail module, project management and accounting, warehouse and manage transportation management, as well as financial management. So these areas are really getting matured, and Microsoft has also released a lot of hot fixes in these areas. So if you are implementing some projects which are focusing on these modules, you can get into this Excel sheet and filter which hot fixes have been released. Right. Going forward. Okay. So now we'll switch to demo. So what I'll do is I'll show you some key features which are very which improves the user experience. So we'll go through feature management workspace, save views, new grid capabilities, and there is a new feature which was released in preview, which is for grouping in grids. That we'll go through. Just give me a minute. I'll switch my screen. All right. So we are in a Dynamics environment. We are on a default dashboard. So first, I would like to show the feature management workspace, which basically can be your landing page. So once you apply an update, you get a notification that features have been installed. So you can open this feature management workspace. Here you have a good categorization of what's new, what's not enabled, what's scheduled, and what, and here you see a list of all the features. So generally when you install a new update, all the new features are shown in this area. So when you log in, you can see there are some features which are in preview mode here. So when you go to preview feature, you can also see this small warning sign there that this is not generally available. It is a preview feature. There are some features which have been enabled. So if you have enabled something, you can see a tick mark and you can see when you enabled it. This little red cross shows if you enable this feature, you cannot disable it. So these features needs to be tested nicely in tier two environments before you enable. So feature management is a good landing page after you apply an update. Spend some time analyzing the features, cherry pick what you want to enable and disable, and then you can start testing them. So let's move to save views now. So what is save views? Save views is basically a feature which allows you to save your personalizations and then you can toggle between them. So for example, I'm on purchase order screen. I'm just taking this as an example. You will notice that it's big bold there, right? My view or standard view. So if there is a standard, by default, there is a standard view available on all the forms. The moment you start personalizing, system senses that you have personalized it. So for example, if I don't want to see mode of delivery on my list page, I right click and hide this. You see a star sign comes here. Now system has sensed I have changed something. If I want to reduce more columns, I'm hiding few things. Then what I can do is I can save this view and let's say my simple list view, and I can pin it as default. So what happens is I can now toggle between standard view. See, if I toggle standard view, all this fields which I made invisible are visible. But if I toggle to simple list view, I get another view. So, and I have also set it as default view. So every time I log into my purchase order list page, I can see that system is defaulting to my saved view. So this can be applied on details page as well, right? So now I'm on detail page. I can personalize it and make it simple. What we can also do is we can manage these views. So if you go to manage my view section, you can basically change your default views. You can rename them. And one good feature is you can also publish them. So with publishing means an end user has personalized, saved his views, and they want to share it with other users. So you can come here and publish this view to a different security role. So you don't select a user, but you select a security role with which you want to share this view. So I can say, okay, this is my role which I want to, let's say, share with my CFO. And then I can also select which legal entity I want to share this into. So I can make this view published in only specific legal entity, and I can then just publish it. It gets published to a role. So everyone who is linked to that role gets access to this saved view. So this is via personalization, guys. This is so that has to be considered. This is not an enforced rule in the system. It is personalization. Users can get rid of it. Users can change their view. So if, for example, you are you have made some field, let's say, just picking an example, I want to personalize something. Let's say I want to personalize sales date, and I want to make it, I'm not getting that view. Users can basically bypass this, right? So if you make some fields mandatory, users can still skip it by going back to default view. Okay. So after this standard view, we will go to the grid feature, which is really interesting. So with the new grid feature, what Microsoft has released is, now I'm on my purchase order details screen. Let me make it a bit simple. I'll just hide a few columns. Let's hide this. that will help us to, let's hide this one. Let's hide. Okay, right. So now you see my purchase order view. So with the new grid feature, we can move columns around in a grid. So for example, if I want my unit price to be next to my quantity, I can hover my mouse. You see these four dots. You can then drag and drop the field. And then you see my unit price is next to my quantity. I can drag fields anywhere I want in the grid. So that's quite handy. If you want to view some information in a consolidated way, one after another, you don't need to customize anymore. You can just drag drop the columns. Another quite famous feature is to view totals. So you need to go on the column, right click, and just say total this column, and the totals appear. And you can add totals on most of the columns which are available. Of course, meaningful, you can't total on unit, but amounts, quantities, all these columns can be used to view the total. So again, this was one of the common extensions companies used to do to add totals on header and lines, but this is now available via personalization. So feel free to encourage your users to use these personalization features whenever there is such similar requirement. Another feature is you can of course hide the totals as well. Another good feature is for bulk editing these data. So what we can do is for example, I have my five rows here. I want to update quantity to 50 in all of them. What I can do is I can have something in Excel. For example, I'm working with an Excel. I can copy the data from Excel and I can basically come and edit it here. And if you see, I can copy paste my data from Excel. Bulk, I can update all the rows in one go and its system will validate that value afterwards. So what happened is I just was able to update my quantity in all the lines by copying and pasting from Excel. So this is another nice feature which can be used to improve the user experience. Another good feature which has been released is, which was available in previous versions of Dynamics, was to use mathematical expressions. So, so for example, if I want to put a price which is 15 into 10, I can do it. So I can use mathematical expressions here, and it's not just the plus and minus. You can also use some expressions. So if you want to see log, let's say logarithmic, so log of 1000 is three, right? So we can use log function. You can use power function. So you can say, okay, 2 power 3 is 8, right? So there are a wide range of regular expressions supported by this. You can use factorial here. So 4 factorial. So yeah, it depends on various companies, right? So you might work with a customer who have some electronic sense data, and you know, all these expressions are required to calculate actually the price. You can use these expressions. So this was about the grid feature. One preview feature which has been released is where you can group data. So for example, I am on purchase order screen and I want to see how many different items are there. I can right click and say group by column. So what system does is it shows you the grouping based on that particular column. And then you can right click and say, okay, total this column and total this column. So now you have a very good view where you can see the items grouped by item number, and you can see the grouped totals as well. So you can see subgroup totals and you can see the grand total. So these new grid features are quite powerful, quite helpful for end users. So doesn't impacts your solution designs, but it increases the wow factor for the end user. So feel free to show it to them and leverage it. There is one new cool feature which I wanted to show is again in personalization. This feature has been released as a preview mode, which is to embed web pages. So I'm on a workspace. I can embed actually external portals which have iframes enabled in it. So what I can do is I can basically right click on my default dashboard. I can say add a page. Here I can say add a website. And here I can give URL. So this is, again, a very powerful personalization feature where your users can actually access in internal portals or different ERP system or an external website, which has iframe enabled in it, right? So it needs to have iframe enabled. This is still in preview mode, so it might not work for every type of website you think, but this is coming. So yeah, this is also another good feature. You can embed your these external URLs in your dashboards, and you can then log in. So you don't need to change browsers, log into different things. You can use Dynamics as your portal through which you can move around. Yep, so that was about the demo. I'll come back to the presentation. Yep, so now we have some time for Q&A. You can all, if there are any questions, Faisal, we can take, but our email address is there, so feel free to reach out to us. And with that, I'm done. So thank you guys for giving this opportunity and taking out time for this session. And over to you, Faisal. Thank you.
Thank you, Ammar and Rajit. It was really good session, very insightful, very solid and great topics. As of now, I don't see any messages into the chat window. If anyone has any questions, please unmute yourself, raise your hand and ask, please.
Hey, Rachit and Ammar, really nice walkthroughs there. I just wanted to ask Ammar if he has any real-time scenarios in the intercompany or the kind of challenges that he would have seen or faced, because the practical challenges could range from valuation issues or organizational policies that the companies are governed by. If there are two different companies and if they are transacting between across the geographies, then if intercompany can handle the export part and incoming quality requirements, freight requirements, those kind of things.
Yep. Thank you for that one. I can coordinate with you over that because I have, and it's always good to share the knowledge. So I have just implemented a few of the clients here in Australia, and I will just share the knowledge with you. And you can just have a my contact through
I can touch email base
or a link. Yeah, you can just
sure. Ammar.
I will let you know many of the things, and we can share.
Yeah, sure. Thank you for that. Cheers. Bye.
And it would be very nice if whatever you guys will discuss, if you can some small documentation on that part. So we will keep this as a repository for our rest of the group members. If they face any scenarios, any discussions in the future, it might help them at some such stage.
Yeah, sure, Faisal.
Yeah, that's a good idea.
So with that one, I don't see any further questions. If you still have any questions, please feel free to reach out to these emails. And we recently launched a new LinkedIn page where we will be hosting. Going forward, we will be hosting all the sessions there. And please feel free to follow that page. All the upcoming updates and upcoming sessions. We are going to talk about advanced warehousing. We are going to talk about how to prepare for the examinations. We are going to talk about in-depth integration stuff and technical stuff, which definitely will help everyone. So if any of you is interested to talk and discuss any topic, it not necessarily be half an hour and or hour topic, you may have some tips and tricks which you just want to quickly show to everyone, maybe 5-10 minutes, please feel free to do so. If you have anything to show, please feel free to reach out to me, Rachit, Ammar, Kamal, Vishal, and Vishan. Feel free to reach out to any one of us. And also you can comment on to our WhatsApp group chat. And also we have the LinkedIn group and a LinkedIn a company page dedicated to this particular discussions. With that one, I'll say have a good weekend, rest of the weekend for everyone. Stay safe and goodbye.
Thanks, everyone. Cheers, bye.